Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Good morning. Welcome to everyone to the Council on Foreign Relations. My name is Michael Waldholz. I am managing editor at Bloomberg News, oversee global coverage of healthcare in all its facets, biotechnology industry, healthcare policy, and I also oversee our global team that covers education. So I'd like to welcome you, as I said, to today's panel conversation on the economic policy implications of global aging. With me this morning is Michael Hodin, who is the adjunct senior fellow and also managing director of High Lantern Group. He's a managing senior fellow here at CFR with an emphasis on aging. So I didn't ask you, but I assume we're here because of you. And also to my left, your right, is David Beers, who is the managing director of Global Health of Sovereign and International Public Finance Ratings for Standard & Poor's. And simultaneously today, Standard & Poor's has put out a study that will be the focus of a lot of our conversation today on the global implications, mostly the financial implications of aging country by country. And to my right is Peter Heller, who is a senior adjunct professor of international economics at the School of Advanced International Studies at Johns Hopkins. I just want to make a couple of announcements. If you have a cell phone with you, just could you please put it on vibrate? And this is an on-the-record conversation, so I hope you won't inhibit yourselves when we get to the Q&A part. As you can count on, even though it is on the record, at least I won't be dashing out. Bloomberg is a wire service, and I'm not going to be dashing out and making a phone call.
You better not.
I'd like to read, actually, in the beginning of our conversation, of an interesting sentence that began the S&P report, which is out today. By the way, the name of the report is Global Aging 2010, An Irreversible Truth. Nice, catchy subtitle. And the first sentence says, no other force is likely to shape the future of national economic health, public finances, and policy setting as the irreversible rate at which the world's population is aging. So that's a powerful way of sort of stating what I guess is the obvious, but one of the issues that one of the central points that we will be discussing today is that while this, while aging is something that we are personally aware of, either ourselves or relatives. It's inevitable, I understand. Better than the alternative, I also understand. But there does not seem to be a sustained or specific focus on the impact of having so many people reach their 70s, 80s, and now very commonly into their 90s. So there's implication, of course, as we know personally, is how we personally can afford it. But then there's the larger problem, especially in countries that have social welfare systems, of what this will do to their budgets and their finances. It's particularly important now when we see the evidence that these countries, that certain countries, in Europe, there's evidence of it because of their debt issues, that every time we have another problem, we sort of go into crisis mode and try to solve it. I think one of the reasons we have the panel today is an effort to begin thinking about what we can do in advance of what may turn out to be a crisis. It already is probably in many areas. Again, I just want to make a statistical point that has been presented to me, is that by the year 2050, the median age of the world population will have grown by 10 years, and that the number of people over 65, the percentage of people over 65, will double to 16% from around 8% now. So with that, I'd like to sort of turn in my questioning. We will, by the way, have a conversation here on the dais for about a half hour, and then open it up to the audience for questions. I'd like to start with you, Mike. If you could, in brief, sort of state what you see is the reason CFR should take a look at it, and the rest of us in the audience.
Okay, thank you, and delighted everyone's here. So we have a lot of sufficient time for discussion. Let me just perhaps make a few points. Some of them I hope will be controversial. The first one, to pick up on what Michael Waldholz just indicated, there are two hard facts here. One is that we're living longer. It's a spectacular result, a great benefit of 20th century science, medicine, and health. The second one, however, is this proportion of people who are over and under 60 or 65. Worldwide, another piece of data, roughly constructed in about 1950, there were 12 people working for everyone who was considered to be elderly, meaning they were, quote unquote, not working. That number declined to about 9 today, and over the next several years, it will go to about half that. This is unsustainable, which is what the S&P report is saying. Second point, therefore, I'd like to make is that we aren't, as Michael said, from a public policy point of view, from government decision-making point of view, addressing this. We're still looking at it tactically. We're looking at it piecemeal. The basic social structures that are seen to be and understood to be supporting as we get older, certainly in the developed world and increasingly in many of the emerging markets, is a system that was essentially invented by Bismarck, changed a little after World War II in the UK by Bevin at the time, and we've made virtually no changes to it. This is quite stunning. The third point I'd like to make is that, therefore, this is less about the data and about tactical shifts than it is about really profound culture and sociological change. And it's going to get worse. What we need to do, I would argue, from a public policy point of view, is think about people working longer, think about a different sociology and culture around this. But in order to do this, we need to piece together the policy work streams of health, how we think about work versus retirement, and the financial set of issues, pension reform, Social Security, et cetera. So I will conclude my couple remarks by showing you sort of three props that I have. And of course, since all of us are aging, I'm not sure how many people can see this, but I'll describe it to you. One is the New York Times. I don't know if there's a New York Times representative here today, a reporter, but the New York Times picked up the S&P report today. There are two things about it that I think are interesting. One is they buried it inside the business section. To me, this is a front page story. Of course, I'm not at the New York Times nor an editor at the New York Times. But the second, more interesting one, is that the headline and much of what they're writing about is S&P says cost to care for elderly will spiral. Yes, that's true, and yes, we have to worry about that. But if that's what we're solving for, we're not going to get the solution here. This is about a shift in life course, which brings me to my two other props. On the health side, obviously, people will not be able to work longer and differently if we don't address the health issues. What is in the vernacular referred to as non-communicable diseases, age-related health disease and conditions, will derail the 21st century unless we address it now and treat health as an investment in order to treat work, retirement, and financial matters differently. So here's a picture that you will not be able to see very well, but it's a picture of, in the early 50s, people with polio in iron lungs. This is sort of the equivalent of this elderly care that we're going to have to deal with unless we address it from the standpoint of Dr. Salk's polio vaccine. Alzheimer's alone is now recorded at basically costing 1% of global GDP, $604 billion. And that is only going to explode. When you're over 65, it's 1 in 3 people who will get it. When you're over 85, it's 1 in 2. We will not be able to afford this, and that doesn't even include diabetes, cardiovascular disease. So if we want to make people who today we consider old, productive workers, contributing members of society and wealth creation, we have to also keep us healthier as we get older. And this is something over the next 3 to 4 decades, not just for tomorrow afternoon's New York Times report. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. You know, as you're speaking, I'm sure all of us are thinking about what does that mean, and I'm sure everyone in this room either has or knows about an elderly relative or friend who is struggling to deal with the implications of frailty and health care that that comes with it. And, you know, in particular, we have been reporting, Bloomberg and others have also, about the fact that Medicare, the rise of Medicare, the amount of money spent on in the U.S. on treating the elderly, the illness of the elderly is almost is rising at a rate that is almost impossible to stop. And one of the figures that always astounds me, and I don't have it off the top of my head, is that some 80% of an individual's Medicare spending, or maybe this is total Medicare spending, occurs in the last year of a recipient's life. And so that issue in itself is something that people are cognizant of, but the solutions for that I have not seen yet. Personally, each one of us probably, again, is experiencing or knows someone who is experiencing someone in their 80s or 90s who requires support and help that the family can't provide themselves. So again, you know, maybe I'm looking at it as we all look at these things from a personal point of view. To take it from the personal to the global, I'd like to you know, ask my colleague to the left here, my conference colleague, to talk a bit about why S&P did this study and what it believes its impact should be now that it's out.
Okay.
Or say whatever you'd like.
Thank you very much. Well, you've given me a broad berth, so I thank you for that. And thanks, everybody, for joining us here this morning for this discussion. Why did we publish this report? Well, you may be surprised to know that this is actually the fifth study on this topic that S&P has published. The first one we did was back in 2002. And then my colleague Marco Mrznek, who's the primary author of today's report, and I were chatting earlier, reminded me there was actually reports in 2004, 2006, 2007, and now 2010. We published these reports for a very good reason as a credit rating agency and as a group that does sovereign credit ratings, the ratings on national governments. We were, you know, aware from the beginning of the decade of the potential impact. And then, happily, thanks to outfits like the OECD and the EU and the IMF, data that could be compared across the range of sovereign governments that we look at entered the public domain. And so we looked at it, and of course we brought our credit angle to the table because we're rating these governments. And basically the objective of our study is to look at these trends on healthcare, on pensions, and related age-related types of expenditures. Look at the starting fiscal positions of governments, which of course have deteriorated markedly in many cases since the onset of the global credit crisis a couple of years ago. And then looking ahead over the next 40 years, say, well, what are the possible credit implications? What, in theory, could this do to our sovereign ratings under different scenarios? The starting scenario is governments doing nothing, which we don't think is a plausible scenario because as you go through the report and look at the at you know today's trends projected forward, what you see is that virtually all sovereigns that we rate at very high levels today would, from the beginning of this decade, starting 2015 and going forward, as this progressive cost impact creeps through fiscally, their ratings would start to fall. And going into the next decade, as these impacts continue to grow, and on top of that, the impact of borrowing money and the interest costs associated with that, those trends accelerate. So we look at a number of scenarios, and this is the most pessimistic one, which is governments doing nothing, and what you end up with is a story which is clearly unsustainable, and practically speaking, would not happen unless, in the worst-case scenario, from a, our perspective, some governments actually ended up defaulting on their debt somewhere down the road because they could not get the policies in place to and create the, importantly, the domestic political consensus around some of the issues we've already raised to keep these things under control. So, so it's really from the credit side that we're approaching this. But as our report notes, there are obvious public policy implications and public policy choices, which I think we're going to get into
yes.
later. So I'll stop there.
Okay. Well, thank you, David. I appreciate that. I'd like to turn to Peter, who has been thinking about what it is that governments and companies, what we can do as, I hate to use this term, as societies. How can we approach this? Is it a challenge that is we should just throw up our hands and say good luck, or can something be? Can we actually begin doing it, whether it's piecemeal or in some sort of broader approach?
No question. We can do things, and there are lots of things we can do. Some of which are very obvious. I'll get to that in a second. But I want to just turn it, and I really welcome the S&P report, and it follows on the heels of four other S&P reports and IMF reports. And what's really interesting, I even wrote a book on this subject about 7 years ago, and not much gets done. And that's really what's really interesting, how hard it is for people to listen on this. And what's really interesting is there's this tremendous uncertainty about when all of a sudden the impact of what's going on is going to hit. I mean, it's suddenly hit in Spain and Ireland and the UK. Why hasn't it hit in Japan? Why hasn't it hit in the United States? Why hasn't it hit in Germany, where we're seeing the market kind of turning as a consequence of realizing that aging populations are sort of an interesting issue? And I think the issue, which is interesting, is that when it hits, of course, it's a terrible bind, and big time adjustments are required. And yet we don't really know when it's going to hit, but we know that it will ultimately hit in some kind of way. And it's much better if we don't allow it to be an Irish or a Spanish or a Greek kind of response, where we have suddenly no time to make adjustments. It's much better if we, as Michael was saying, we have a long time to think and make these kinds of adjustments in terms of thinking about retirement age and thinking about how to redefine the social welfare framework to sort of be able to accommodate a much older population in terms of what's fiscally affordable. And it's much better if we can allow expectations of everybody to change gradually rather than have to force change very quickly. But it's even harder for governments, because to make the changes that have to be made, basically. Because some of it is hard, and it's very hard to do, and some of it's very obvious. I mean, we know we have to push the retirement age back, the age of eligibility. We know that people are going to have to work longer. But it's much harder to know what to do when we're talking about medical care, or we're talking about long-term care, and how do we contain the cost of medical care to be affordable for these elderly people and whatever, and how we redefine what's eligible and what's not eligible for benefits and whatever. These things are much, much harder. And it's much better when we do this in a longer-term kind of framework and with lots of advanced time. The other point I want to make is that we know the government has to do something. We make cutbacks and whatever. But what we don't really have much conversation about is how it plays out in terms of the non-government sector, how households adjust, how companies adjust, and what the implications are. For instance, if we're going to retire later, and if government's going to cut back on the benefits, we're going to have to save more. And how does that play out, basically, in terms of macroeconomic effects? I mean, if you look at the UK and what's happening there, we worry in the aggregate economy, do we have enough global demand taking place? Well, the UK is not going to be a source of demand. The Italian, the Spanish, the Irish, the Greeks, they're not big players, but they're not going to be a source of demand. And so there are these kind of these macroeconomic effects that take place because people adjust their work behavior and their savings behavior, and we don't really know how these play out. But what we do know is that people will react in a rational kind of way, and so we may be seeing, for instance, the Germans saving as much as they are, and the Chinese saving as much as they are, maybe very rational ways of approaching their needs to deal with as an aging society. And these may not be, you might say, what we would like to see at a global level for a global economy to prosper. And so there's a real challenge that we all face in terms of reconciling what nations have to do in terms of dealing with an aging population and what we need to do globally for the global economy to be a vibrant kind of place. And that we don't think that way. We just think, oh, well, we're all going to have to adjust our fiscal regimes, cut back in government demand. And we don't think about what are the implications of those kinds of cutbacks in terms of how we all behave and whether it allows us to have a rational macroeconomy.
Well, you know,
and that's something which is going to be a problem for global economic policy coordination looking ahead.
Well, all great points, Peter. But what I think the question I'll bet you everyone in the room is thinking, the gorilla in the room, especially here in the U.S., in which we have such a politically divided country,
right,
in which rational approaches are so difficult to pull off. And given the fact that it's not that, I've talked to Mike Hodin a lot about this issue in the last few months, and his concern is that it's just not being addressed, and he's doing his best to get it in front of people. The S&P report probably will garner some attention, but, because we have so many other pressing issues on a national scene, the economy, of course, we're in the midst of two wars. One war, at least. The other one is just simmering, I understand. The global warming is clearly something that for which we hopefully will have some sort of rational approach. But I have to tell you, maybe it's my cynicism as a long-term journalist, that I just don't see that happening. Let's focus on the U.S. for a second. What could be done here as far as making this what needs to be done? Maybe first start there, specifically in the U.S., and what could be done?
Well, first of all, I think this issue is certainly politically more real in a lot of the European countries, and in the Chinese, and a lot of countries are actually much more actively kind of digesting and focusing on this in terms of policies than we are. We seem to be really stuck. It's much harder politically for us for some reason. But what can be done? We know a lot of things we know what to do. We know we have to push back the age of eligibility for retirement benefits. We see how difficult it is politically. Look at the French. But we know that has to happen. There's no question about that. We know that there's going to be a sort of more means testing taking place in retirement benefits. In a way, those are really the easy, obvious answers. Much harder is on the medical care side. How do you contain the rate of excess cost growth in the medical care sector? Is it that you phase out coverage for medical benefits for things like dental care, like the Dutch have done, or maybe psychiatric care, or certain types of medical procedures just are no longer covered by the government? Do you maybe say have a much higher copay and a higher deductible for people who are, say, 65 to 80, and you phase down those things for people who are older as a way of forcing people to pay a much higher share? The government is an enormous player in the medical care sector. Maybe the government should be really saying, we're going to compensate geriatricians a hell of a lot more than we're going to compensate radiologists. The government is the biggest player in medical care in the United States as well as in any other basic industrial country. There's no reason why we can't start reorienting incentives to be dealing with elderly medical care. Maybe we should be stimulating a lot more attention, as the Europeans are, in terms of home care for the long-term aged, for those who are disabled, thinking of ways to get people like me, who's 64, taking care of my, I don't need to take care of my 94-year-old mother because she's quite sharp, but her husband died of Alzheimer's and her boyfriend is, she has a boyfriend, 92, and he has Alzheimer's, you know, and maybe I should be taking more role in terms of that. We need to be introducing the United States of value-added tax because a value-added tax allows, you might say, the burden of these things to be shared across generations and not just the working age population and payroll taxes. So these are some quick ideas of...
Thank you very much, Peter. Maybe, Mike, I know you've been thinking about things, specific policy changes, both you know by governments, by industry. Maybe share some of that with us.
Thank you. And again, I think this is a great discussion. I would take us back to basic principles. And perhaps argue a little with my colleague, Peter. Firstly, I would focus us that this is a cultural and social shift, or a sociological shift, which is huge, but it is that. Secondly, again to emphasize that what the S&P report tells us about global aging is more about a demographic shift than it is about there's going to be a lot of 92-year-olds who we have to take care of or not take care of. Both are true, but the only way we're going to get to the profound policy shifts is if we understand this as a life course. Some of you may know that just in the last 2 years, the World Health Organization finally appointed an individual, John Beard, who is directly responsible for something he calls Aging and Life Course, who reports directly to Margaret Chan, the Director General. And so for the first time, they're trying to look at this holistically. My third point I would make is that, coming back to the earlier tactical components, I believe that if we look at this as, you know, how do we reduce medical costs? Or what's the issue of moving, as you say, you know, the retirement age by a year and a half or two, as President Sarkozy is trying to do? Or we've done in this country by several years. We're just not going to make it. Rather, we have to start with the picture that we're looking for, and it is to keep people healthier longer so they can work. And I'm actually much more optimistic, and I think we can do this. Inside many, many companies today, around this country and around the world, in the insurance sector, in the banking sector, in the healthcare and pharmaceuticals and technology, are people looking at innovative solutions for this new demographic cohort that is going to be a great opportunity for them over the next 10, 20, 30, and 40 years. And bringing those people together to ask what they need to facilitate the kind of innovative solutions that will get us there, I think is one of the ways to go about this. It's sort of a Manhattan Project or a space race type of challenge, which we haven't looked at yet in that way.
Okay. Go ahead.
You know, I disagree in some ways. I mean, I think, well, first I would say you're absolutely right about the Alzheimer's. The numbers you cited are absolutely correct. And that's a tough nut. It's an enormously tough nut, which we haven't begun to face. And even if we stood on our head now medically, we don't know how to treat Alzheimer's. So that's going to be a burden that we're going to have to deal with people living longer. But let me tell you, people of my age of 64 are living long, are living healthy. We know we are living healthy. We know that we're going to be living a much longer time. So I don't think that's the problem, at least in this country. It's a problem in China, but it's not a problem in this country. The real problem is that people expect to retire at 65, and they haven't adjusted their expectations to the reality that they're going to probably have to work longer. And how do you get those expectations adjusted to what people already know? People know that, you know, that they're going to be living longer and more healthily, you know. But what people don't realize is that they're going to be, there's going to have, the people who are 50, those of you who are 50 now need to start thinking about the fact of that you're going to probably be working when you're 72, and you may need to at some level. And that, those kinds of adjustments of expectations are what's really hard to incorporate.
Can I just jump in and talk a little bit about the politics of this? Because I think the reason, just to remind you why this is so difficult, is because we're talking about sort of intergenerational sort of equity issues among other things, you know, which is how do you share the fiscal burden, you know, between the people who are alive today and our children and our children's children and so on. And that's true on pensions, but it's also true if you decide not to to borrow for today's publicly funded healthcare pension, you are shifting the burden to people in the future. And of course, in most political systems, democracies and otherwise, these would normally be intractable issues, and they are certainly proving to be intractable today. So I think, you know, when you look across the democracies of the world, I mean, Peter was talking sort of hopefully about Europe. As somebody who's living in the UK, I need to remind you that, first of all, the present coalition government has taken healthcare off the table for budget cuts completely. We're still waiting to see what the increase in the retirement age will be. I know it's coming. And so what the British government, in fact, is focusing on, as most European governments are, is not so much on these issues right now, the demographic issues, but how do we close our budget gap over the next 5 years? Now, whether you, from a public policy or from a political or economic standpoint, think that that's a good thing or not, it still raises the issue, well, when are they going to get around to dealing with these longer-term issues? And I think that's the story in a range of countries. So I think as a practical matter, we're likely to see two sort of political outcomes here. One, for reasons we can speculate about, somehow government, through strong leadership at the top, begins to build a consensus around these difficult issues. The other possibility, however, which we're beginning to see in Greece is a paradigm of this, is that crisis will force the political system to address these issues. And when you think about it, in the long history of democratic systems, it very often is crisis that causes people to begin to make hard choices that they put off along. And maybe we need to, in thinking about this issue, also get away from the idea that crisis is necessarily bad. There are also opportunities that come out of crises. And I mentioned, I'd like to talk about Greece, because now Greece, entirely because all the other choices were taken away from them, have now embraced one important reform, which is actually a very dramatic increase in their retirement age, which puts, you know, what the French are aspiring to do very much in the shade. So if the political system survives this, and if the country survives the trauma of what they're going through right now, they're actually going to come out with a much more sustainable pension program than many of their European peers, whereas, of course, previously their peers could look at them and say, oh, they're even worse shape than we are, so we have nothing to learn from Greece. So there's also going to be a demonstration effect, I think, that can be constructive, both from the crisis-affected countries and also for that group of countries that is very difficult to identify today, where political leadership is going to rise to the occasion, which is going to be forward-looking and thinking about the intergenerational issues. And as a pragmatic analyst, it's hard for me to see that that's going to happen until we actually see some more crisis situations, which I think will begin to inform the debate among neighboring countries and globally.
Well, thank you, David, because that sort of encapsulates a bit of the way I think about how change occurs. Usually, most of us don't make significant changes in the way we live unless, of course, we personally face crises, need for change. There is a certain amount of belief that the marketplace itself, the so-called invisible hand, is moving us in this direction anyway, especially as a member of the baby boom generation. You know, we always, you know, clearly are in the vanguard of social change and cultural change. But you can also see, you know, my elderly mother, she's only 86 and sharp and on her own, but lives within a retirement community that, in fact, is surrounded by six or seven other retirement communities and has had an enormous impact on the politics and civic life of the town that they live in. because there are all these elderly people who need services. In some ways, they provide help for each other so that they can live this way. There is a culture there of understanding frailty and disability and all the support services. It's sort of just occurring because they need it and they're making it happen. But the government of this small town is also very cognizant of services they need to bring to it. So, in some ways, these things just begin to happen. And as you see them, of course, they can be embraced by governments as something. But I think the other point is that Mike would make is that when we reach this crisis point, there ought to be some ideas laying around that people can grab onto, as opposed to, last minute, last ditch sort of, seat of the pants kinds of decisions. I'd like, because we do have about 20 minutes left, to open it up to the audience to either make a comment, but also, more importantly, a question. Yes.
Dave Walker, the Peterson Foundation. First, I'd like to compliment S&P for doing this report, but I would also like to say the reason it's probably not going to get much attention is it really isn't news. I mean, this is something that, frankly, we've known for a long time, and frankly, I think when you look at the headline doesn't grab you. I would respectfully suggest that the age-related spending will push sovereign debt to unsustainable levels absent of reform, and frankly, a lot quicker than 40 years from now. I mean, you tell politicians something may happen, and it may happen 40 years from now, it's a yawn. One of the concerns that I have, and this is a question, my profession, among other things, is a certified public accountant. Yours is obviously doing credit ratings, including sovereign debt. I'm concerned that both are very myopic and very much subject to tunnel vision. And when you look at the U.S., for example, we've got huge off-balance sheet obligations, and we've got debt that we don't even want to count in our debt-to-GDP ratios. I'm not talking about unfunded obligations. I'm talking about trillions that we owe to Social Security and Medicare, which if we were honest and we counted that, we'd be debt-to-GDP of 92% growing rapidly. What about interest rate risk? What about currency risk? I mean, these are things that go far beyond default that don't seem like they're being adequately focused on, given the fact that we're in global markets, and especially in the United States, where almost half of our public debt is held by foreign lenders. And so it's not just a matter of default, it's a matter of what's the interest rate risk and what's the credit risk, and not just over a year or two when we're in a weak economy, but over 5 years, 10 years. If you will.
Okay. So I guess if I understand your question, it's why aren't we taking these factors into account? And we obviously argue that we would. So I think the fact that we've been writing about this issue, the demographic effects of on public finances for the last 8 years demonstrates that we do take these things into account. And then you mentioned the other sort of tricks of the public finance trade, various off-balance sheet devices. We've been writing and monitoring them in a long time. And when we think in the sort of, 3 to 5 year horizon that, our ratings practically address, these things are material, then we will take action. And I would urge you to read the report as opposed to the New York Times account of the report. And what you'll see is that we're saying is that, for some of the, 49 governments that we're looking at, and that's in a universe of the sovereigns we rate of 126, the next 5 years are critical. And if we believe that the policy debate is going nowhere, then you will start to see ratings impact. I mean, it's more difficult to respond to the question you're raising about the marketplace. And we know, if we've learned anything from the latest crisis, and certainly what we're seeing in the Eurozone right now, the markets are amazingly myopic. And this is a truth, another truth that I think will go on for as long as markets exist. I like to remind people that on the Eurozone, the markets were pricing Greek debt at near AAA levels for over a decade now. S&P was downgrading many of these sovereigns in the interim. No impact whatsoever. And now the market has lurched dramatically in the other direction. This is a pertinent issue around the topics that we're talking about today also, because there's the famous story of Japan. The conventional wisdom holds that just because most of Japan's debt is financed domestically, they have nothing to worry about, even though on top of their more severe demographic problems, they've got one of the highest debt burdens in the world. And I wonder if that complacent analysis is true. We certainly don't believe it because we've been downgrading Japan steadily when the market still discounts them as a unquestioned AAA sovereign. Because it assumes that people in Japan are myopic and indifferent to these issues and will blindly keep buying government bonds at between 0.5 and 1% in nominal terms indefinitely. And there's no particular reason to suppose that that's true. What we don't know is when that dynamic begins to change. But I suspect when it does, it may be a very dramatic shift and a sudden one. But difficult to predict from a timing perspective. But it won't be because people don't understand the issues. It will be because markets, for reasons that none of us can fully explain, look at this stuff and say, it's not going to happen next month or next year or the next 5 years, so I'm going to try to trade around what I think is going to happen now. And then suddenly it shifts. So we'll see.
Mike, did you want to add something?
Yeah, just the couple points. As we're all saying, there are a lot of very important and venerable institutions that have been addressing this issue. But I do think, David, that and you yourself, both in your book and your current position at the Peterson Foundation. One of the points about the S&P report, which I'm not sure is that perhaps needs a little bit more highlighting, is perhaps less the issue of this debt to GNP or GDP ratios, the fiscal and economic crisis that it leads you to, and as much it calling out that it is around this demographic shift, that it is around this population issue that is, as you point out, the single largest driver and will be the single largest driver. Those two components together are critical, and I know others have focused on it, but it perhaps brings us back and very relevant for intellectual and policy consideration in a place like CFR, where is there a way to organize differently a set of thinking around the policy reforms and the social changes that are needed? We do address this from a balkanized point of view, inside governments and elsewhere. You look at the OECD, and you have work being done on labor. You have work being done on health. It's not being pulled together. So is there a way to take this report and others like it and other writing like it and say, well, maybe there's a different way to organize? And if organizing it differently gives us a way to bring different otherwise balkanized groups together, we may have an analytical approach to beginning to drive to solutions. The second point is around something you mentioned, David, which is in the report, that your presumption that this is a crisis, but we're not going to get to the place because governments will not do nothing. Perhaps another way to look at this is, how do we define doing nothing? If doing something is around the edges of modifications to current pensions, Social Security, and health care, but not profoundly looking at the changes that are needed given this true demographic shift that we're now observing, then governments really are doing nothing. If we think that current approaches to reforms at the edges are doing something, I think we're fooling ourselves. And so that's another point that I think your report highlights and perhaps is a driving intellectual component to think about.
Yeah, I think...
Peter.
You know, we are in a global economic crisis still. You know, growth has been downscaled, and you know we have insufficient demand in the global economy, and it's a problem. And what I think has been missed in all this is that the aging of the populations is a factor that's underlying this, and is a force that's influencing what's going on. When we think of aging, we can think of the industrial countries, but we should remember that more rapidly aging than anywhere is China. China will age much more rapidly than the U.S. or the industrial countries because it faces an even larger aging problem than we do without any kind of social insurance framework for all intents and purposes. And the fact that it is aging, and they know that they're aging, is influencing a lot of the way in which they behave in terms of their exchange rate, in terms of their savings behavior, and whatever. And the point I'm trying to make is really that, you know, when we think of global macroeconomic policy coordination, we don't think of how the aging of the populations is influencing how individual countries are behaving, so to speak, and whether that's influencing the policies that are required at a global level. It's not on the table, so to speak.
Right.
It should be.
Yeah. Well, thank you. There's a question in the back there. Also, just identify yourself when.
Yes. Good morning. I'm Joseph Shammy at the Center for Migration Studies.
Yes.
And for full disclosure, I'm the former director of the United Nations Population Division that produces many of the numbers on the estimates. I have a couple of comments. One, a criticism of the report. I think it's rather simplistic. First, what are the causes of this aging? You never talk about fertility. Although people are living longer, the major engine driving population aging is fertility reduction.
Yes.
And the more rapid that decline comes in, the more rapid the pace of aging going on. And as Michael was saying, this isn't simply the elderly. It's an entire effect from age 0 to 100 plus. It affects every age cohort. The second issue is you don't talk about decline of the population, which is also going on. So that's a double whammy. Not only are you getting aging in Japan, Korea, Germany, Italy, and these countries, but you're also getting population decline, so the labor force is declining. So I think in the next report, I think you should bring in fertility reduction, where the fertility is, and what's happening, and the future size of the population and the labor force. So it's not only the ratio between the workers and the retirees, it's the absolute size of the labor force. And that then brings you to the issue of what can be done. There's immigration that can have an impact on the labor force, but not on the aging, of course, because the workers also age. So I would suggest two things. One, look at the causes, what's driving it. Make the report much more relevant and policy driven, because then you look at the causes. Right now, the 50 pages you have here, I think a freshman in college could produce this. For S&P to produce this and then expect the New York Times to have something on there. The other point I want to make has already been made. Alfred Sauvy and Frank Notstein, demographers from the 40s and 50s, have been expecting this. We knew this as demographers, this was coming. The reason that nothing gets done is because governments don't respond to the long term. We are telling them that the expectations of life expectancy for the U.S. are underreported. There are many demographers saying that the U.S. government and Europeans are underestimating life expectancies. So my question to you is, why don't you take this more seriously, more comprehensively, instead of taking it simply charts about ratios between GNP, dependencies, and aging? It's much more complex than that. And if you expect there to be a real response to the aging, you're going to have to bring in many more people and have a meeting more than an hour. You have to bring in people who are talking about technology. You may have people living to 120.
Okay? Other than that, Mrs. Lincoln, how is the play?
Yeah. Well, on behalf of the Council of Foreign Relations, we apologize for letting you down. And also for Standard & Poor's, I mean, there are two things to say about this. One is I should emphasize on behalf of my firm in all humility what I said at the beginning, which was we had a specific set of objectives in mind. And so we were a piece of a larger puzzle, the broader debate that we're talking about this morning, but since we're a credit rating agency and we think about government creditworthiness, that was the particular, take that we were putting on this. Secondly, I want to reassure you that in terms of your criticisms, remember all this data, all we're doing is aggregating the data from various sources, including the United Nations. So it's not like we're deliberately obscuring or overlooking some of the other dimensions of the demographic story that you're talking about. They're all there in the data. But I just want to remind you that since we're not demographers, we're not the font of all wisdom about the demographic challenges and population aging. We were simply approaching this from, you know, our perspective. And to the extent that we add to the public debate about that or not, it doesn't, that's all very well if it does. If it doesn't, we'll continue to do what we do on the rating side. And as I mentioned before, when we think governments aren't addressing these issues in a way that will hurt their creditworthiness, their ratings will come down. And where we think they're doing things that will help their creditworthiness, their ratings will go up. But I just want to just make clear that we're relying, in fact, on the analysis that your organization and all the other organizations I mentioned have been doing, and then applying our particular piece, which is the credit piece. And that's what we aim to do.
Thank you. Peter?
I can't resist. I heard Joseph talk a few years ago about Sydney, and he was talking about China, and I just read a Harvard report about how is China going to manage its aging population looking ahead, which is going to be dramatic. And their answer was pretty much the same answer that Joe gave a few years ago, which is essentially people are going to work until they die. There's not going to be much alternative, and they're going to pretty much pay their own medical expenses. Yes, there's pensions, there are some medical care, but largely that's going to be how it's going to be resolved, is people are going to work essentially until they can't. And that's... they have no alternative, really. And the Harvard report says, well, you know, people will start, markets will adjust, companies will realize they need labor, and they're going to hire more elderly workers, and people who are not in the labor force, females, will have fewer children, and they can work longer, and can work more, and that's going to be how China continues to grow and resolve its problem. It's not a very comfortable solution when you have, like we have, the expectations that somebody's going to support our retirement. Well, there are other countries, large countries, that are going to deal with it very differently.
And Peter, so it was down the ages.
Yes.
Bismarck came along and invented the social safety net.
And we need to start adjusting our expectations. I mean, interesting statistic. Americans age 55 to 65 have net worth of no more than about $200,000 at most. Most Americans, 85% of Americans. Social Security and a $200,000 bank deposit at 65 ain't going to get you very far in terms of standard of living.
Just, you know, because we have only a few minutes left, I do want to open it up to another question. Is it right here? Right here. Right.
I'm Mike Poulos from Oliver Wyman. I also was surprised that we got to minute 50 of a 60-minute debate before we started talking about essentially the supply side issue of human capital. But in terms of a policy response, I'm surprised that we haven't addressed the issue of human capital and the systematic underinvestment in human capital. What most of the social welfare states have done is essentially socialize the benefits of there being more children. And so people very obviously free road on the fact that that you didn't have to have your own children to support you in your old age. Someone else's children would support you. So it seems to me that there's a very obvious set of policy responses if you need more people to encourage. I mean, and China went obviously the other way. Singapore, there are a lot of examples of countries that purposely took essentially a short-term view of their human capital stock to depress their dependency ratios in the short term, but created a huge long-term problem for themselves, and we did that in a different way in the West. So I'm just curious if anyone has any ideas around the likelihood that particular aspect of the policy debate, where that's going to go.
Yeah, well, good point. That does get to the heart of, where do we go from the set of data, the statistics, the facts that, as you've said, have been around for at least a few decades. Someone a few moments ago talked about needing a crisis. We all can remember what Rahm Emanuel said about a crisis. I'd go back to the point of having this particular topic as a policy organizing mechanism for further research, further economic and demographic study that leads to driving change. And incorporate in that, which is particular perhaps to America, but critical, what is required in the marketplace from a public policy point of view to drive toward innovative solutions. Not so much how do we put more money into Social Security or how do we spend less money on medical care, but how do we, you know, cure Alzheimer's? How do we really restructure the learning environment, which is what you were alluding to a few moments ago, so that people can have a life course of work? And those are things that are taking place in the marketplace. Some of them will be enhanced by, I think, public policy reforms or facilitated. Some of them will just take place in the marketplace. But having this as an organizing framework is something that hasn't happened. If you take the U.S. government, for example, there is a department that in HHS, an assistant secretary for aging. It's sort of like the witness protection program. You know, and if you look in other parts of the government, you don't have this addressed. Think of other topics of the sort that Michael alluded to, like environment or gender, HIV/AIDS. You will find places at state and treasury and a whole range of places which have those being addressed. You look at the G20 and you're not getting a kind of collective approach. You look at the UN and you have the Millennium Development Goals with aging absent. I mean, it's stunning. The numbers were there. I don't know what they were thinking. There are these eight Millennium Development Goals, and aging is not there. So this is an organizing mechanism that can drive the kind of framework for policy approach is itself something that I think is required. And I applaud S&P and IMF and the others who are bringing this to our attention.
Well, I've been instructed to end the session directly at 9, but my guess is, and I guess the hope of Council of Foreign Relations and folks here up on the dais, who I want to thank for your participation, as well as the robust questions we got from the audience, we're not going to solve anything in an hour. Maybe we have focused our attention. And each of us can go back to our own activity or a place of work or whatever and perhaps begin to raise this as a concern or begin other conversations or activate some of the research that Mike says we need. This is perhaps not nearly the beginning of a discussion on the implications of aging, but we're certainly still at the beginnings of it. And I look forward to a lot more conversations. And as someone in the press, look forward to opportunities that we can have to generate, at least in the U.S. and maybe globally, a national or international conversation. Again, with that, I'm ending the panel conversation. And thank everyone for coming this morning. Really appreciate it.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.